Welcome back, everybody, to more Let's Play of A Little Lily Princess. I am, of course, Shadowblazer 3000 here for you guys. Excuse me. Well, in the last episode, of course, we learned that these schoolgirls, of course, are indeed really terrible people to each other. And we got to learn about doll magic and all sorts of fun stuff. Let's progress. Let's proceed. Would you like to sit in front of the mirror while I brush your hair, mademoiselle? Oh, I don't think so. Not by the mirror. You see, it is nice to sit and think while you run the brush through my hair. Sometimes I remember stories or think of things I want to say to someone else. Other times I think it helps me relax. It must be like that for Tybalt when someone is petting him. But if I were looking into the mirror, then the Sara in the mirror would be looking back at me, and we should have to pay attention to each other, or else we might be thought impolite. Mariette laughed in the back of her throat. That is as you wish. I had thought of doing something different with your hair. If you could see, then you would know more quickly if you thought yes or no, and I could change it if you did not like it. Well, I think it's better to look at it when it's finished. If you stop reading a book in the middle, you might have all the wrong idea of what's it all about. Then I will show you when I'm done. Mariette is so kind. I would be terribly lonely in these rooms without her. The school is full of other girls, but they are like me, guests of Miss Minchin. We live in the same house, but they're not part of my household. Mariette, the only person who belongs to me. Kind of unfortunate implications right there. I know they're not trying to go mean anything bad by that. Let's just press on, okay? Let's not dig that hole any further. It is nice to sit and think of while she brushes my hair. And she has a better way of with it than my old Aya did, but I do miss my papa so. If he were coming to visit me, some girls' parents do now, how happy my life would be. I wonder where my papa is now. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to speak. No, it is good, mademoiselle, you should speak your thoughts. Your father sailed many weeks ago. By now he is in India, yes? Home and safe, thinking about how different the house seems without your footsteps. Oh, I didn't want to think of him sad and lonely. It is right that he misses you, and that you miss him. That is how things should be. But that does not mean your life is nothing but sadness, does it? No, I do not think I am melancholy. Of course not, because you're not named Haruhi Suzumiya. Really lame joke there, sorry. I would not wish to be. I enjoy my books and my friends. So you see, your papa, he will be lonely, but he'll also feel other things. He will live his life, but he'll also think of you. I believe you will hear from him soon. Oh, I hope you are right. No, you must be right. My papa will write me letters soon as the ships can carry them, and I will treasure his words. Oh, the days before emails and telephones. Well, I guess there were phones. I mean, we're probably like circa 1916 or something. Because if I recall, the story takes place at some time during the First World War. But honestly, telephones were such different beasts back then. But definitely, we're long before the days of email and air travel and instant communication at our fingertips. And I do hope that my papa has a friend to care for him as Mariette cares for me. Alright, so let's do something, shall we? Let's shake it up. We've been reading the book on the first day of the week and it clearly doesn't do us much there. Patience. Okay, I don't know what actually helps for patients. Let's practice dance. We'll have a tea party. We'll play with toys. We'll write in our diary. And we'll read a book on the last day. Dancing. Visiting. Play. Writing. So, plus one knowledge, plus two artistry, plus two vigor, plus three sympathy, plus four belief. Well, look at that. Patience needs to get up. But everything else is pretty high until our next weekend activity. But I could skip it if I just want to try and max the skills out. But I'm too invested in getting all these stories from every and learning about every character. That's more of an achievement hunting thing that I do on my own time. While Sara was walking through the school, she heard a great commotion coming from a nearby room. The first high-pitched shriek made her startle, concerned that one of the younger girls might have injured herself. Sara was a quiet and solemn girl herself, but made no judgment against those whose temperaments led them to cry out loudly when they were in pain. However, the wailing went on. More and more angry than miserable, the voice recognizably was Lotte's. Sara came closer and began to make out the accompaniment of frustrated adults that had been drowned out by the childish tantrum. What are you crying for? There is nothing wrong with you. Oh, oh, ow! Oh, I haven't got any, Mom, ma. Stop crying, for heaven's sake. Whoa, I haven't got any mama. I'm guessing that means she's crying out for her deceased mother. You ought to be whipped. You shall be whipped if you do not hush, you naughty child. Lottie wailed more loudly than ever. Miss Minchin emerged from the room, her hands pressed to the sides of her head, and paused when she saw Sara lingering outside. Oh, dear Sara. Look at that smirk on her face. Miss Minchin attempted producing a friendly smile was not at all convincing. Lottie's roars continued unabated with each burst of sound, made Miss Minchin's shoulders twitch. I stopped because I knew it was Lottie, and I thought perhaps, just perhaps I could make her be quiet. May I try, Miss Minchin? If you can quiet that, you are a clever child. Dreadful thing, we may not be able to keep her. But you are clever in everything, my dear. I dare say you can manage her. Go in. When Sara entered the room, Lottie was crying upon the floor, screaming and kicking her small fat legs violently. I really am sorry I'm not putting a lot of effort into it. Once again, I like to stress, I'm not an actor. I know I'm kind of doing the voices and kind of doing the accents. That's just for the fun of it. But I'm not by any means a professional actor, and I don't have any aspirations to be a professional actor. Especially when I have to do little girl crying voices. Sara stood by the howling, furious child for a few moments and looked down at her without saying anything. Then she fell down flat on the floor beside her and waited. Except for Lottie's angry screams, the room was quiet. There was a new state of affairs for Lottie, who was accustomed to hearing other people's protests, implore and command and coax her by turns. To find the only person near her did not seem to mind the least. How she kicked and screamed was unusual. It made it unnecessary for her to pause her sobbing in order to see what was going on. She opened her tight-shut, screaming eyes to see who this person was, and found it was only another little girl, but it was the one who owned Emily and all the nice things. Sara looked at Lottie quite curiously, but said nothing. Lottie sucked in a gulp of air, but the noise she made sounded rather half-hearted. "I haven't any mama." Or ma. Neither have I. Lottie blinked rapidly at this unexpected answer. Her legs and arms ceased their kicking and lay flat against the floor. Where is your mama? She went to heaven, but I'm sure she comes out sometime to see me, though I don't see her. So does yours. Perhaps they both see us now. Perhaps they are both in this room. Here! Lottie sat bolt upright and looked around, seeing nothing. Her face began to scrunch up again. We can't see people who live in heaven, even when they come to visit us. They travel like wind or sunlight. You can only feel them for a moment if they touch you. Then they're gone. They can go anywhere in an instant, but most of the time they stay up above. Their lands full of lilies. Fields and fields of lilies or lilies? That's an unusual voice. I figured lilies would be I-L-L-Y-S, but what do I know? This is why spell checker ruined your life. And when the soft wind blows over them, it wafts the scent to them of the air. Can't read some of this dialogue. It's good, it's just very classy, very formal. I can read fine. If anybody's wondered, I really can read fine. It's just reading aloud is the hard thing for me. Always has been, really. Everybody always breathes it, because the soft wind is always was blowing. Wind and sunlight, the streets are always shining. And little children run about in the lily fields and gather armfuls of them, and laugh and make little wreaths to wear in their heads or spin cloaks and dressed of soft lily petals. The petals never go dry or brown, but when the children grow tired of them, they toss the petals into the air, they turn to clouds. Lottie had by now quite forgotten to cry, was leaning forward, hanging on every word Sara spoke. In that shining city, people are never tired. However far they can walk, they can float anywhere they like. And there are walls made of pearl and gold all around in the city, but they are low enough for people to go and learn to lean on them and look down onto the earth and smile. From those walls, sometimes they dance down to visit us. Other times they whisper beautiful messages into the wind and hope that someday we will hear them. Oh, I want to go there. I haven't any mama here. Sara saw the danger signal and took hold of Lottie's hand with a coaxing little laugh. I will be your mama in this school. We will play that you are my little girl and Emily shall be your sister. Shall she? Yes, let us go and tell her. And then I will wash your face and brush your hair and both of us shall have a little bit more family. Oh, that's so sweet. We haven't spoken to Ermin, whatever her name is. But we haven't spoken to her in a while. I know it could go with Lottie just based on what we had, but let's talk with Ermin. Or however you say her name. I should really just watch like a couple of Let's Plays of this or something, like first few episodes. I don't want to spoil the rest of the game for myself. Ermengarde sat contentedly on the floor of Sara's room, listening to her read from one of her storybooks. And then he offered to take her away to his father's court, where he would make her his bride. The maiden adored the prince whose company had charmed her for so many hours, but could not bear to leave his sisters without first telling them farewell. She bade the prince to leave and return again the next day, to the place in the woods where they had met. Sara did not read the words exactly as they were written, but put her own little touches upon the story and make it turn out the way that she'd prefer. I do that sometimes. It was not quite the same as telling her own stories, but Ermengarde still seemed... Garde, I don't really know how to say these names. Still seemed nervous at the idea of stories that had not come from books at all. It was a first step. Once he'd gone, she had rushed back to her home to take up her work at the wheel, planning to spin twice as fast to cover her absence. But when she sat down at the wheel, she was dismayed to find her magic gold thread had lost all its brightness. Her heart beat fast, and she wept bitterly, for she remembered her mother's warning and knew not what misfortune might now befall her. Oh, it sounds like it's Sleeping Beauty. She was so afraid that she'd be punished for what she'd done that she ran away without telling anyone what had happened, not even her beloved sisters. She ran through the woods looking for her prince, but he was on horseback and long since gone. And while she ran, she did not watch where she was going, and she tripped over a root and fell into a rushing river, disappearing into the swift current. Thus misfortune was complete. She drowned. Not quite. Sara continued the story, how the maiden was transformed into a golden water lily. Or maybe it's the swamp princess. I don't know, actually. No, I don't think so. The spinning wheel sounded like Sleeping Beauty to me, but then again, I don't really know the original story outside the Disney version, which obviously is going to be very different. So anyway, Sara continued her story, how the maiden was transformed into a golden water lily who sang in her sorrow, and how she was at last restored to life by the love of her sisters. It must be a totally different story than I don't know what it is. Airmen sighed in contentment. When I hear stories in your voice, I can almost see them happening. You are much better than books. But what about the prince? Does he marry her in the end? He rode over the bridge by the river and heard her singing, but he didn't do anything to save her. It was her sisters who loved her enough to took her to look for her when she was lost. I thought princes were always heroes. Anyone could be a hero in the right circumstances. I don't think I could. She looked around Sara's room, decorated as if it was with the best of the last three countries, dependable England, refined France, and exotic India. Do you miss being in India, Sara? Yes, of course. It was my happy home. I was happy there. I had my house and my pets and my ayah, and the skies were never foggy and gray like they are here. Here in London. I loved living there. But most of all, because it was where my papa will be. Airman saw Sarah's face suddenly change. A cloud seemed to pass over it and put the light in her shining eyes. She drew her breath in so sharply that it made funny, sad little sound. And then she shut her lips and held them tightly closed, as if she were determined either to do or not do something. Have you a pain? There was a moment of silence in which Airman worried that she might have spoken out of turn. But at last, Sara answered. Yes, but it is not my body. Her voice was low and somewhat unsteady. Do you love your father more than anything else in this whole world? Her mouth fell open a little. She knew that she would not be correct for it would not be correct for a respectable child at a select seminary to say that she did not adore her father. Could not imagine being even. She did not adore her father. Could not imagine being ever so much as fond of him. I'm not quite understanding the sentence. It's a little weirdly structured. Sorry, guys. Alright, I should just move on. This is not reading comprehension.
I scarcely ever see him. In fact, she did her very best to avoid being left alone in his company for more than a few minutes. It was not proper feeling for a daughter, perhaps, and it was clearly not something that Sara would understand. Airman was indeed greatly embarrassed. He's always in the library, reading things. There's a wealth of information in that statement if Sara had been inclined to decipher her, but she was too preoccupied with her own feelings. I love mine more than all the world 10 times over. That is what my pain is, He has gone away. She put her head quietly down on her little huddled-up knees and sat very still for a few minutes. Ehrman had an idea that if she had been like any other little girls, Sara might suddenly burst out sobbing and crying, but she did not. Her short black locks tumbled about her ears, and she sat still, then spoke without lifting her head. I promised him I would bear it, and I will. You have to bear things. Papa is a soldier, and think what soldiers bear. If there was a war, he would have been marching... Yeah, maybe this is different. Maybe it doesn't take place during the First World War. Maybe he would have to bear marching and thirstiness and perhaps deep wounds, and he would never have to say a word, not one word. Ehrman could only gaze at Sara, but she felt that she was beginning to adore her. She was so wonderful and different from anyone else. Presently, Sara lifted her face and shook back her black locks with a queer little smile. If I go on talking and talking, I shall bear it. I shall bear it better. You don't forget, but you bear it better. I will talk to you as much as you like if it helps you. New week. I'm going to cut this episode a little bit short. Unfortunately, my throat's kind of going on me now because I just recorded two of these back-to-back, 20 minutes apiece. It's getting a little on me. So, guys, I'm going to wrap it up here on this new week. I hope you guys are still enjoying the game. I know I am. And I hope that you'll continue tuning in for these episodes to come. Thanks for joining me. I'll see you guys next time.